And another Starship hop.
Wow, Elon is really spoiling us. If he continues like this, we will be getting used to see Starship hops, as if it was nothing special anymore. So besides the SN6 hop, what else is going on at SpaceX and Boca Chica? Turns out, a lot. Super Heavy assembly is starting. We have another Starlink launch. And Elon said some very interesting stuff about settling Mars and future Starship testing.
And what are the others doing meanwhile? Northrop Grumman, for example, is testing the space shuttle, the SLS solid rocket boosters. Wow, look at this! 9 years after the retirement of the space shuttle, we can witness the almost exact same boosters being tested again. Real innovation at work here, ladies and gentlemen. This might be a rant-heavy episode again, so stay tuned.
So SpaceX's Starship SN6 prototype took off to the skies in the second 150-meter hop in just a span of 1 month. Elon, you are really spoiling us. If SpaceX continues like this, Starship hops won't even make headlines anymore. But that is of course the plan. The hop of SN6 seemed to go pretty smoothly and according to plan, as compared to the SN5 hop. This time, the liftoff was a lot smoother. No large pieces of debris flying around, as we can see in these aerial shots here. Only a small piece of debris. We don't know what exactly it is, but it looked a lot less dramatic than the one from the SN5 hop. The hop altitude was again around 150 meters, the same as with SN5 and Starhopper. The landing also went well. Here we can see the landing legs extend. After landing, however, there was a fire or burning on the lower end of SN6, which had to be extinguished by this water cannon here, as we can see on this as always amazing shot from Boca Chica Gal from NASAspaceflight.com. And please also check out and support their channel, because they always record amazing Starship footage. Moreover, we can also see that the Raptor engine didn't catch fire, as this was the case with the SN5 hop, where the engine caught fire in the last second during descent. So all in all, it seems that despite the flame event in the end, and the very small piece of debris flying off in the beginning, the hop went smoothly and was an improvement as compared to the SN5 hop.
Besides Starship, Elon has announced that work on Super Heavy is starting now. The Super Heavy high bay has reached the highest level. It stands at an impressive 80 meters and will soon receive the roof, which is just in time for Elon's announcement on the virtual Humans to Mars summit that Super Heavy construction has actually already started. He also revealed that the giant booster will have 28 Raptor engines, a small downgrade from the 31 Raptor engines he was talking about last year. But don't be disappointed, because this will still be twice the thrust of the good old mighty Saturn V, and that the thrust per engine will be increased to compensate for this reduction in engine number, yielding around 60 million pound force of thrust. At the very same Humans to Mars summit, he also said that the first Mars missions will be pretty dangerous, and while they will be extremely exciting, there will also be quite a high chance that the first settlers will die. He said, quote, "I want to emphasize this is a very hard and dangerous and difficult thing. Not for the faint of heart. Good chance you'll die. And it's going to be tough, tough going, but it'll be pretty glorious if it works out. Let's hope that the settlers will die of old age on Mars, and not because of accidents or hazards, because Arnold already taught us 30 years ago that there are a lot of dangers on Mars." Elon also said that SpaceX will want to conduct hundreds of unmanned Starship missions before attempting to land on the Moon and Mars with humans. Interestingly, his wording was, "We've got to first make the thing work. Do hundreds of missions with satellites before we put people on board." Aha, with satellites? What satellites could he mean? Before we answer that question, please consider subscribing to this channel, as we really need your support to continue talking openly about space politics and especially exposing corrupt companies such as Boeing, and of course expose wasteful government spending on the monstrosity that is called SLS. Thank you very much.
So, which satellite? Of course, Starlink. We know that this mega constellation will sport at least a mind-boggling 12,000 satellites, possibly even up to 42,000 satellites in Earth orbit. However, getting so many satellites into space with Falcon 9 will absolutely not work, while a Falcon 9 rocket can launch 60 satellites at once. Starship will be able to launch 400 Starlink satellites. That's right, friends, an almost 8 times increase per launch. So the full Starlink constellation can actually only be accomplished with Starship. Thus, the Starlink internet network will not only generate huge, really huge revenue for SpaceX, revenue that will even surpass NASA's annual budget, but no, it will also serve as a test for Starship and Super Heavy. Isn't that freaking awesome? Kill two birds with one stone, so to speak. Pure genius. So talking of Starlink, just last week, we could witness another one of those Starlink launches. Of course not yet with Starship and Super Heavy, but with the good old Falcon 9, carrying 60 more satellites into orbit and increasing the number of the satellites to 713. The internal beta testing looks quite promising. And in this video here, link in the description, we talked about the first latency and speed results. Already in February, SpaceX told the FCC that Starlink would have less than 50 milliseconds of signal lag. And the first results from the internal beta test confirmed this, with latency possibly as low as 20 milliseconds and 100 megabit download speeds. These Starlink test results could improve SpaceX's odds of winning a share of the FCC's $20.4 billion Rural Digital Opportunity Fund, meant to subsidize high-speed internet in the United States. Excellent. This money would of course then help to fund the development of Starship and Super Heavy. So not only two birds with one stone, actually three birds. If SpaceX could get a portion of this fund, which we really hope. So while SpaceX is as always working on the most transformative and disruptive space vehicle in the history of humanity, what are the other space agencies and companies doing meanwhile? As you might have guessed, not so much. On this channel here, we often ranted about the insanely laughable and slow progress of Blue Origin with New Glenn, or ULA with SLS, about Boeing's continuous fails, or even Lockheed's slow progress on the Orion spacecraft.
But we haven't yet ranted about another good old lobby company, namely Northrop Grumman. So we'd say it's about time to change that. Because now they have begun testing their SLS solid rocket boosters, as we are shown in this impressive video. It would actually really be quite impressive if there wasn't the small detail that these boosters are actually slightly modified and slightly improved space shuttle solid rocket boosters. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. 9 years after the retirement of the space shuttle, 29 years, repeat, 29 years after the first flight of a space shuttle into low Earth orbit, Northrop Grumman shows us the almost same boosters from back then, as if it was something new and amazing. But okay, let's not be too brutal to poor Northrop, because the boosters indeed do have some improvements over the shuttle boosters. If we compare them side by side, the SLS boosters are a bit longer, 54 meters as compared to the shuttle's 45 meters. They thus can hold 20% more propellant and provide more thrust, 3.6 million pounds each, as compared to the 2.8 million pounds for each of the shuttle boosters. They also have a new nozzle design, asbestos-free insulation and liner configuration, new avionics, and improved non-destructive evaluation processes. Sounds not so bad, and normally we'd say cool. I mean, there's a 28% improvement in thrust. What's there not to like? Well, what there's not to like is the following. SpaceX went in the time span of not even 10 years from the Falcon 1, which had a thrust of 450 kilonewtons, which corresponds to around 100,000 pounds, to the Falcon Heavy, which has a thrust of 3.4 million pounds. This is a factor 34 improvement in 10 years. And now the evolution continues with Starship, which of course will be even more insane with 60 million pound force of thrust. If Starship flies next year, this will be thrust-wise an improvement of a factor of 290 in 13 years. An increase in payload capacity from 180 kilograms for Falcon 1 to 65 metric tons with Falcon Heavy, a factor 361, and probably a bit more than 100 metric tons to LEO with Starship. This is a factor of at least 555 increase compared to Falcon 1. So in the same time span where SpaceX achieved these insane increase factors, Northrop achieved to improve the space shuttle boosters by 28%. Repeat, 28%. Oh, and did we mention that these boosters were actually already started for the Constellation program? That's right, friends. These solid rocket boosters were originally planned for Constellation, which already received $4.8 billion in funding from 2006 to 2010. So they've been in development for 14 years now.
And how much will these boosters cost per SLS, you ask? Well, it's estimated that the cost for Artemis 1 alone, which is the unmanned mission around the moon with SLS and Orion to be launched in late 2021, will be a relaxed $889 million. So almost $1 billion for a 28% improvement of solid rocket boosters that go back to the year 1981. Impressive. So this is what always makes us angry, dear viewers. Almost as angry as to make Hulk come out. Now the boosters themselves make us angry. But no, the wasteful spending of government money and outdated technology. While all the while, there's one company out there that does improvement of factors of hundreds in the time span of 10 years and is being completely ignored. Because of course, we have to keep the dollars flowing to the good old lobby companies like Boeing, Lockheed, and Northrop. Fortunately, with the latest hop of Starship SN6, with the assembly of Super Heavy starting now, we are extremely confident that next year we will witness Starship fly to orbit for the first time. And when Starship and Super Heavy become fully functional, the death knell will have rung not only for these solid rocket boosters here, but also for the rest of SLS and for Orion. And we have to tell you, we cannot wait for that moment to come.
And if you want to see us bash ULA, not Northrop Grumman, you can watch this video here where we talked about their shady business practices.
So thanks for watching the JI Space Report. And I would say, on to the future. Shady business practices. Ha ha ha.